Very good. All right. 6 p.m. work session meeting in Newburgh City Council. Called into order. The first item this evening on the agenda, Department of Public Works resolution declaring police and DPW vehicles and equipment as surplus. We have a 94 F-250 truck and an older Chevy vehicle within DPW. Some equipment that we declare as surplus and sold. With police, they have an older Impala and some tire changing equipment as well that we are going to declare as surplus and sell.
And then we're replacing this with when we get our bond, right? That equipment that's there.
So the bond covers some of these items. The bond, namely vehicle-wise, covers a number of patrol vehicles for the police department. We're also simultaneously working with Enterprise on a lease management program for non-patrol vehicles throughout the city, whether it's pickup trucks within DPW, detective administrative vehicles within police, other vehicles within water and rec and elsewhere. But we did not want to lease out the patrol vehicles.
Right, and that makes sense to me. And leasing vehicles for the other departments makes sense.
Very good.
Sounds good.
The next item number two, we are going to reject bids for bid number 1-1.20 for the Lake Drive Bridge Replacement Project. The bids came in about $600,000 over. What we are doing is reducing or taking a better look at some of the bid specs that will be put back out. We're going to be limiting the right-of-way type of work that is taking place as well as the paving and some stone replacement items. The issue here is there's a water main exposed in a stream close by to Machados Lake, and we need to make sure that is protected as well, too.
How many bids were in total?
There were six bids altogether. It's in your packet, so all the backup information's in your packet. There were six bids altogether, and the lowest bid was still $600,000 over the budgeted amount for the project. The city has a grant loan. This is a state-financed project,
mm-hmm.
But we don't have additional money above and beyond what we're getting out of the state contract. So we can't make up that $600,000.
Gotcha.
So there's ways to revise the bid specs and put it out and hopefully get something back that's within the budget for the project.
Now, under normal circumstances, this would not necessarily cause a delay. At this time, we are anticipating completion winter 2020, start date fall of 2020. What that entails so far as the current situation with COVID is yet to be known, but those are still the dates as of right now. We are working hard to identify some public transportation routes around that area, whether they be funded publicly or privately. It's something that Councilman Sklar's and I know Councilman Grice and many others have been very active on. So this is a very serious issue that we're taking. We're firing on all cylinders to resolve this matter as quickly and efficiently as possible.
Thank you. I just had two quick thoughts on the Lake Drive Bridge. I did want the community to know that the Lake Drive Bridge is separate from the Lake Street Bridge, that we know that's a project that those residents that live in Lake Street are very concerned about, with that bridge getting fixed so that they can have access to Lake Street. But then on the Lake Drive Bridge, I just want us to keep in mind some of our future plans and how that works in, which I'm sure our hardworking engineering and DPW department are doing.
Yeah, also in regards to the Lake Drive Bridge, I know that there were some additional paving that's supposed to happen. So because they were able to do some of Lake Drive, and the reason why they said they didn't do the other half of Lake Drive in terms of the milling and paving was because of the bridge. And I think that if we could kind of keep that in the same conversation, once we find out who we're going to go with after the procurement process, has been complete. If we can just kind of get an update on that as well.
By all means.
Okay.
The next item this evening is from State Environmental Facilities Corporation, namely the Drinking Water State Revolving Fund. It's a resolution accepting a proposal and authorizing the city manager to execute a contract with Arcadis for bid preparation and construction management professional engineering services for the SCADA improvement project at our water treatment plant. As you'll, I'm sure all recall, we were awarded a $3 million grant not so long ago from the state, coupled with another 0% EFC loan for the remainder of this portion. And this resolution will allow for us to move forward with already funded through grant awards, the SCADA work, which will bring our water plant into state-of-the-art operations. The next two items were originally placed on the agenda a few weeks ago in anticipation of the summer and just in anticipation of the many great events that the city has annually. While the future is unknown as to how we will be proceeding with these events moving forward as it relates to COVID, what we wanted to do is it put the two items, both donations and contracts regarding city annual events, on the agenda to be voted upon if and when there is a need for us over the next several months to start the planning process for these events.
So, if these events are canceled, will this money that's being will go on to the other events, or how does that work out?
Now, if we receive donations for each specific event, they have specific budget lines. So there is a special trust and agency account, particularly for Memorial Day Parade, for 4th of July fireworks, for the Black History Pride, National Night Out, and the International Festival. So the money would go in, and if we don't, if we're unable to hold those events this year, the funds would be available for using for the event in a future year.
Gotcha.
So I just have two questions. The first question is about the 4th of July. And so what I was hoping was that we can do some, I don't want to say fundraising, but you know, some donations for that, that would be very helpful. I know that that company has always kept a steady price with us, and it's, you know, the community has been very satisfied with that show. So just wondering about that. My other question is about the Black History Parade. I know there was some discussion last year when we first brought that back. So I'm just curious about the dates and who's going to be in charge of that. Those are my two questions on that, but I'm thinking we're not ready for that yet.
For the 4th of July fireworks, in the past we have received donations to offset the cost of those fireworks. So to the extent there's anybody listening who's interested in helping the city find funding sources for that, that could happen at any time. Then for planning purposes, if the present health crisis subsides, we can talk about operation and logistics for those events that would be upcoming in May and June.
Okay. Also, I want to add that the Black History Month annual parade, which was initially set up and organized by former council member Hillary Rayford, has sort of turned over the reins to the Black History Month committee. Okay. With Sadie Talley and Tiambe Talley Carter. I had a conversation 2 weeks ago about that. Mrs. Talley called me. We had a lengthy conversation about what the expectations were if she and her daughter and that committee took over the parade in terms of organizing it and et cetera, et cetera. So that's sort of still being considered because Miss Sadie Talley, who was named in honor of that for that parade, didn't give me a confirmation that the Black History Month committee is going to take it on. because she wanted to have that conversation and know what the expectations were, what were the responsibilities. She also wanted to know if the city was allocating financial resources to it and or tax liability. So those two questions need to be addressed. I told her no, there were no funds for it, and then I also said that they would have to come up with their own insurance. Is that true?
If the city is, so the way these resolutions are worded, we would have a donation line. So any funds that could be raised to support that, it would be a city event. The city comptroller has consulted with our insurer. There's a way to insure these events that is separate and apart from the city's general liability insurance.
Okay.
So it wouldn't be carried as a regular claim against the city. It would be a single one-day special event policy. So that may change the city's exposure and change some of the concerns that some of the council members have raised. But it's good to know that there is somebody who may be interested in administering.
Right.
I've worked with Tiambi Tally Carter when she was with the city and in other iterations. So you know, if that's something that they want to take on, I'm confident that we would be able to
move forward. Thank you.
The next item, we have some housekeeping items related to the releases of covenants, both at 24 Temple and.
Okay, I can run through these really quickly. 24 Temple Avenue, the city sold that property in October of 2019. It was sold to the owner of a nearby property to help him protect his investment in the neighborhood. He has completed the renovations. There is a report in your packets from the building inspector. There are currently no open code violations. There's no obvious violations on the property during the inspection. All the permits have been closed out. There's a valid rental license and a valid certificate of occupancy, and the staff is recommending that you authorize this release.
Mm-hmm.
103 Washington Street. This one's a housekeeping item. The city did convey this property out in 2002. The deed covenant can no longer be enforced. The statute of limitations has expired, and the city is trying to also sell this property to another third party who had their title company ask us to release the older covenants. So as we convey out, we'll have other ways of monitoring the rehab of the property. The next item on 158 Johnson Street, this was a mortgage that was issued by the former Newburgh Community Development Agency, which, as you know, has been dissolved. The city remains the successor in interest. This property is actually being sold by the current owner. They asked us what the payoff amount on the mortgage was. We gave them the payoff amount. They have transmitted the funds, and therefore they are entitled to a satisfaction, and we are recommending that you authorize that satisfaction.
Mm-hmm. The next item from County of Orange Summer Youth Employment and Training Program. We have a total of 13 young adults we are looking to take on as seasonal employees this coming summer. 12 of which will be provided to the REC, one will be provided to planning and development. As this body may recall, last year, this is a service that we were able to utilize for some summer cleaning initiatives across the city. And at this time, there's no reason to believe that we wouldn't be moving forward with this. The deadline to apply is coming up, so it's listed on the agenda as such so that we can move forward accordingly.
Will they still be doing the street cleaning again this year?
Subject to change, yes. I mean, we're open to any type of guidance or suggestions that the council would have. You know, I think the street cleaning last year was certainly a terrific start. I think there's a number of things that we could do to build upon it as well. But then again, you know, I think what's critical and most important about this, regardless of the work that is getting done, is providing some of our young adults here in the city with seasonal employment.
Just to piggyback on that comment, I definitely would love to see some element of the street sweeper program continue, especially during the spring and summer seasons, as you know, we see litter everywhere in the city. Although a couple weeks ago, I don't know what happened, but Broadway was really clean in comparison to what it's been. So I want to kind of reiterate what Councilman Grice is getting at. And then the other thing is, Joe, can we get an update at some point on where we are with the rec department and its leadership in the rec department?
Certainly.
Okay.
And how many people did we...
Councilman Shakur, can you please speak into your mic? We're streaming live, so...
Okay. How many people did we employ last year?
Last year was a little bit higher than this. What we've done is we've also circled back with all the different departments to see whether or not they would like to, if they have a need for this. There's a couple different requirements and thresholds that we're working with the county on regarding the seasonal employment. It was below 20 last year, if I'm not mistaken.
It was 16. Last year the resolution was for 16.
Three more than this year.
Did the application go in already?
No, the application has not gone in already.
Okay, because one of the things we did last time, and this is for Councilmember Shakur, was that if anybody from the council was interested in hosting an individual, you could go ahead and add to the numbers, right? But you'd have to take responsibility for managing, overseeing them, and you know, almost coaching and mentoring. But it could be an extra individual to assist.
Yeah, I know NYSET was part of the program because we had some young people.
Mm-hmm. I think last year it was, there were the vast majority were again in the recreation department. Then I think planning and development took two, and then I think, if I'm not mistaken, Councilwoman Mejia had one, and I think so.
So
I think
it was 16 total?
It was 16 or 17 last year that we applied for. I'm not sure how many actually were assigned, but we applied for 16 slots.
Right, so if there's anybody on the council who would be interested in hosting one, you need to let the staff know. So you need to let the city manager know so that they can go ahead and put it in. There's a form that you fill out with, you know, your information, what the projects, projected projects are, so that they can go ahead and submit. So.
Okay, so how much money how many kids, how many total people can we hire? How does that work out? Besides, I know we have to.
So I'm not sure what the maximum number is. It's just we have to be able to say that we can provide meaningful work for the number of people that we're requesting. So based on the workload of the managers, this is what they can handle.
Right, so remember, this is a countywide program, right, that's right. Sponsored by the youth department that they have. Right. And so they get applications not just from municipalities, but also from nonprofits, some of the for-profits who are, but the main part when they assess the applications is what is the job, right, that's being made available to them.
Right.
And
right.
Then they decide, right, because we can ask for 40, right. And then they say, we're only going to give you 5.
Right.
Because it's at no cost to the city except for the mentorship and experience that's given. That obviously has a cost with staff because obviously the staff takes time to have conversations and coaching, et cetera.
If you look in your packets at the resolution, behind the resolution is the blank, is the memo from the Orange County department that administers the program, cover memo, and then the application that the city will complete is in there. It's blank now because we have not completed it. We just need the authorization to make the application.
Right.
And it provides some of the requirements that we would have to fulfill on the last page. And then what we included for you also was last year's resolution and last year's completed application and agreement, so that you can see exactly who was supervising and exactly what we applied for. So you can we're going to probably adopt this resolution tonight, but in the next couple of days, if you find that you have a need and you can meet the requirements, we can add you as a supervisor in the application process. Okay?
Okay.
The next item this evening regarding professional services contract with Legal Services of the Hudson Valley. We were recently awarded the city's RISE 3 portion of our grant. A segment of that portion is going to be used for some outreach and educational services provided to the community regarding housing rights and tenant needs and other issues within that realm. And thankfully, Legal Services of the Hudson Valley is going to be a terrific partner to provide those services to the community.
Mm-hmm. Just for transparency purposes, I will recuse myself from this particular item. My wife is employed.
Actually, it's not a prohibited conflict. It's okay. It's nonprofit. I've gone through the analysis, and because we only have four, in order to approve the resolution tonight, your vote would be needed. So by the rule of necessity.
So it's not a conflict of interest.
I don't believe there is a conflict. Your spouse is an employee of the agency. She's not receiving. She doesn't have an interest in the company in and of itself.
Okay.
If she did or if you did, there is an exception that applies for non-for-profit organizations, so it doesn't make it prohibitive.
Okay.
And it is not a conflict that requires recusal on your part. Had we had one other council member here, I would have let you recuse out of an abundance of caution. Okay. Not because you have to.
Right.
But here we would need your vote to approve this tonight.
Okay.
And, thank you, Mayor Harvey, for that. And that would be on the record, right? Just to,
it's
I'm
all
thinking
on the record.
To protect.
Yeah. Also, with regards to RISE Phase 3, Mr. Donuts, I just want to ask, does this agreement that we have, or if it passes, with Legal Services of the Hudson Valley, does this have anything to do with setting up the advocacy element that was discussed up at the Harvard retreat?
So this would work hand in hand with that, yes.
Okay.
This would be the first step with increasing outreach,
right,
from the nonprofit legal community.
Okay.
For advocacy purposes, both within housing and tenancy.
And moving into that direction. Okay, thank you.
The next item this evening, we're amending a lease with United Way, who currently occupies a space at 123 Grand. As we all know, United Way has been a tenant there for some time, and they are downsizing and amending the lease to a six-month tenancy.
Did we pull the property sale?
I'm sorry.
Skipped, nope. 82 Clinton.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're purchase of 82.
Yeah, before we get to 123 Grand, we do have one property sale for your consideration. Anthony White has made an offer for 82 Clinton, which is the property where we demolished the garage in the back.
Right.
This would be subject to owner occupancy, and it would be subject to the owner occupancy restriction. His application appears to, he's got the capacity to make the renovation. He's been pre-approved for a 203K loan. He's relocating to the area. I know that if the Planning and Development Department was here, they would be very excited about this sale.
Okay. How much money did we spend preparing that for property? Because I remember it was a lot of money.
The demolition was very expensive. But one thing that we have to be careful of is the liability or the expense that the city incurred or that a prior property owner would have incurred. It's not appropriate to pass that on to an innocent third party purchaser. So We are getting a fairly good sum of money for the property, $66,000. There's a lot of money that still has to go into the rehab, but it would not be an appropriate thing for the city to try to recoup the cost of the demo from an innocent third party.
Sounds good.
So with the amended lease, United Way will occupy one office within $123,000 for a rental of $650 for the next 6 months.
You know, I certainly, especially in times like this with COVID-19, I certainly think that organizations such as United Way should have a presence here in the city of Newburgh. And so I understand with their restructuring and other things that, you know, they don't need as much space. But I'm happy that we can come to a mutual agreement.
Very good. Item number 13, we're renewing a license agreement with the House of Refuge for their farm market located at 140 Broadway. This agreement's been in place since 2012. Obviously, we are bringing this to the council this evening for the agreement to be renewed. Given the current events regarding public gatherings, we don't yet know the impact this will have on operations and events such as this, but we want to nonetheless bring it to your attention for vote so that we can move forward from a planning perspective.
Now, I know and am aware that this agreement goes back to 2012. I just want to make sure there are no legal issues with its title as the House of Refuge. I know they go by the name of the cathedral now, unless there's something I don't know.
We received an email from Bishop Woody.
Okay.
But he did not indicate that there was any change in the name of the organization. So if we find out there's a change in the name of the organization, we'll address it accordingly.
Okay, I just
but we'll follow up.
Okay.
I'll follow up. This came into one of my assistants, and I wasn't aware that there might have been a change in organization, but I do have Bishop Woody's email, and I will follow up regarding the name change.
Thank you.
So this agreement has been in since 2012?
No, we had an ongoing agreement with
annually
with them, and at the time in 2012 when that agreement was first established with the city, they went by the name of the House of Refuge. But since then, I know the church and the church organization has renamed itself.
Yeah, I understand that part, but the market.
The market, yes. They've been continuously operating that market, and it's a Tuesday farm market in front of the Mid-Broadway property in coordination with Orange County, and they've been doing it annually since 2012. This is probably the seventh or eighth renewal of the agreement.
Right. And so, just for a point of clarification, I want to make Mrs. Kelson aware of the name change just for legal and documentation purposes. So that, you know, she can just make sure that that's not an issue.
The next item, Sports New York Play Ball Grant presented by Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center for $5,000. This would be apply and accept. There is no match here. If awarded, the city would use this generous grant to purchase baseball and softball equipment for our youth. And move forward with our terrific summer programming.
Right, so I just want to mention one of the things that when I first got elected, one of the things that really intrigued me was our baseball field up at Delano Hitch. It's been one of my pet projects, if you will, and I've still been in contact with all of those organizations, specifically the Red Storm. I met with them just the other week, about 2 weeks ago. This grant, I'm just really excited for it. I hope that we do get it. It'll just really help with youth baseball and getting the necessary supplies and all of those things that they need.
Thank you. Item number 15 is a license agreement with Mountain Valley Guides. This would be for use of the boat launch. for kayak rentals and other tours this coming summer. And again, this license agreement is put in place so that we could proceed accordingly, and obviously we'll make whatever changes are needed should the opportunity or circumstances arise to do so.
How much does these licenses cost?
This particular agreement?
The fee for this license is $750. This is something that was presented to the council back in 2016. This provider has continually offered these services to the city. Council has seen fit to renew. There are some information about tours and rentals from past years that are in your folder. And most of the people who have participated have readily enjoyed the access to the river.
So, because I know somebody approached me about
jet skis.
Huh?
The jet skis.
Jet skis, right, because somebody approached and said, is it possible that they could do the same thing with jet skis as far as rental, have a rental, whatever this is, like, whatever's
so
in place here, a license to jet skis?
The issue that we have is the Washington Street Boat Launch was constructed with funding from the DEC.
Okay.
We have to be mindful that the primary purpose of that boat launch is to provide fishing access.
Mm-hmm.
Kayaks and non-motorized watercraft are less disruptive to the sport of fishing than motorized watercraft and jet skis. So in order to we would have to get permission from DEC to authorize any kind of motorized watercraft to be rented from that location.
They would have to talk to you.
I just want to make the same comment that I made the last time when this came. I'm hoping that they'll do the same, do some outreach to our youth. I had always thought that's the price that it is the price that it is. But I'm just hoping that they can do outreach to our youth to make sure that City of Newburgh youth are aware of this and participating in it.
If you look at the $750 is what the vendor pays to the city for the use of the space. If you look into the information that he provided last year at the request of the council, he has provided discounts for the tours and the rental equipment. When I if it's approved and I send it back to him, I will ask him if he could make some arrangements for trying to provide some access for our youth, some tours for our youth.
Thank you.
Also, I know we've had this Mountain Valley licensing agreement in previous years. I just never have physically seen the kayaks and that activity. Has anyone else?
No.
I think Councilwoman Abrams did when she was on the council.
Okay.
So he's primarily there on weekends.
Okay.
And he's there as people sign up. So some, it depends on how many people sign up. He's had tours that have canceled, maybe because of weather or not insufficient
right.
numbers. So if you look through the last couple of pages where the emails are,
mm-hmm.
He says they're not renting individual kayaks. They're renting tours to be out on the Hudson River. It does take a little bit more. That's not where a novice wants to be, honestly.
Right.
So they do take people out on these guided tours.
Okay.
So if you wanted to just go out for the day on your, on your own, that's not the service that this particular vendor is providing.
Now, what's the timeline that this
He starts in May and he goes through October.
Okay.
So if you have a group that's looking for a day out on the water,
yeah.
that's what he's looking to do. Or if you can cobble together a couple of subgroups,
yeah.
That's what he's looking to do.
Yeah, because my wife and I and the kids, we went out kayaking last summer, and we drove all the way to Cornwall. Because for some reason I didn't know how to connect with this service. I would have done it from here. The other question, tying into Councilman Shakur's question with the jet skis, I know, Michelle, at one point, Mr. Kaplan had said that he was going to provide some jet ski services from his area or launch behind the factory. Is there any traction on that?
This is the first time I'm hearing about anything connected to Mr. Kaplan. So,
okay.
And it's also the first time I'm hearing about jet skis.
Okay.
So, again, we have to be a little bit careful with what we can't just unilaterally implement programs at the Washington Street Boat Launch. It is a process where we have to request permission from the DEC. Going back, just circling back to the ideas for city residents, as I'm scrolling, as I'm skimming through this, the email, the provider has proposed a resident sunset paddle for an hour on like Wednesday evenings.
Okay.
At a relatively low rate of $15. He also has offered some preseason discount tours, $30 for their sunsets, and then something else, maybe not locally, but if they had transportation. So he's open to ideas. So
right.
If anybody has ideas and you want to suggest them to me, I certainly can communicate directly with him.
Well, one big thing, because I remember when Mayor Harvey went canoeing or kayaking, because I couldn't make that date, so I was a little
right.
jealous with his family out there. But one of the big things is to make sure that he's advertising it very, very well so that people are aware.
I think maybe what we can do is have him connect maybe with city manager's office.
By all means.
And then we can see if any of the offers that he's made can be communicated through the city's social media accounts. So anybody who's dialed into those accounts would then see those a little more readily. So we can try something like that.
Yeah, also, one last point on this item. I know that going again back to Mr. Shakur, Councilman Shakur's question with jet skis, I know that there's a high demand or desire for particularly our youth and even our family members to participate in that type of water sport as opposed to kayaking. You know, when we look at target audiences and target markets and business, we know that I know that there's been a lot of questions and a lot of ask from our constituents, particularly young people who want to participate in water sports such as jet skis and what's the other one when you get on the with the actual ski foot things,
right.
water skiing and jet skiing. If we could somehow look into that, and maybe we have a different location than the Washington Street launch. Maybe there may be somewhere else off of the waterfront that we can look to create that opportunity under the rec department in the near future.
The next item this evening is regarding applying for a Challenge America grant from the National Endowment for the Arts in the amount of $10,000. This would be to conduct an art survey of the community. The issue with this is it's apply only, and we are working on a manner in which the Arts and Cultural Commission would be able to provide the match if awarded. So this resolution, when voted upon later this evening at the council meeting, will be apply only.
Okay.
So what does that mean, community outreach, as far as?
Last year, the Arts and Cultural Commission applied to the National Endowment of the Arts to do a arts and cultural survey of all of our resources here. And some of the feedback that they got was, if I understand this correctly, and it's in here, the narrative's in here somewhere, is that they got some feedback where their recommendations that came back make sure that the underserved populations in Newburgh were getting access and knew about and could participate in all the arts and cultural resources that are being inventoried in the survey. So in order to do that, they are looking for a grant to undertake a marketing and an outreach campaign to find out who the underserved, to get to that underserved population and make the connection mm-hmm. to the arts and cultural resources that we have. So if you, the information,
But who will be doing the outreach? That's
we don't know. We have to be determined. We have to get the grant first. If that's something that you're interested in, I'm sure Mayor Harvey can put you in touch with the Arts and Cultural Commission, and you can have some input that way.
Gotcha. Thank you.
So the next item here this evening will be authorizing the city manager to execute routine instruments during the COVID-19. Epidemic that's going on. So what this would do, and I'll let Corporation Council speak more about this, but it'll allow for myself to work with Corporation Council and all the other city staffs on issuing and executing satisfactions of mortgages, judgments, and then the releases of restrictive covenants for 60 days moving forward. So what this would then do is it would remove some of these items from the agenda if we were looking to reduce the time of these meetings for whatever public reason, public health reason moving forward.
So we would have, so in the next 60 days, if you're unable to meet or if we needed to streamline the agenda, you wouldn't have three of the items that were on tonight's agenda. The city manager would be able to address: one, the statute of limitations has run, the mortgage has actually been paid; three, the staff has recommended that all the criteria has been met, and so we could try it for 60 days. It's a limited time. Once the health emergency hopefully subsides, then the council would be free to continue to receive that information and authorize themselves.
Right. So I'm fine with it being for a limited time, but I know that each and every council member has had questions when those situations have come up. But for the limited time, I don't see a problem with it.
Okay.
Very good.
All right.
The next resolution, the request of Councilman Grice. I don't know if you wish to speak directly about this or?
When I was a young child, I was a Head Start kid. And then when I moved back to the city of Newburgh, I worked first at Head Start. So I've been a firm supporter of Head Start of Eastern Orange County throughout the years, even when I left to work for the district. So they have a week of the young child. Their event, because of COVID-19, they have had to change their event. They have been in contact with me. They do not have an update on what those events will look like. I do want to thank the mayor and fellow council members for seeing it in their goodwill to pass this resolution for declaring April 11th to April 17th, week of the young child. It is still week of the young child, even though some of the events will have to be changed because of COVID-19.
Very good. And then up for discussion this evening, we'll be amending the rules of order and procedure during the COVID-19.
So this is just a housekeeping item. A number of provisions of the open meetings law have been suspended by the executive order of the governor, including having all of these meetings open to the public and having them be able to attend in person. What the general counsels and chief legal officers of most of the municipalities that I work with are recommending that, in addition to relying on the executive order, that the councils pass resolutions or amendments to their rules, their order, procedures, any other items that they have pertaining to items that address their meeting procedures, and suspend those as well. So if we're going to close these meetings to the public and not have a public comment period, then I'm proposing that you suspend Rule 7 of your Rules and Order Procedure for at least the next 60 days during the health emergency while the meetings are closed to the public.
Okay, yeah, so also if we amend the rules of order for the procedures of the council meetings in regard to COVID-19, I think it's important to provide some sort of vehicle or some sort of communication opportunity for the public via email, and trying to figure out what email that's going to be and or who's going to respond to those comments, and have access. So I think that's a very important part if we're going to amend the rules. And then the other element is if we're going to suspend the public comment section, is it at all possible to do it that way?
Right.
You've already closed to the public. So when you move into your council meeting tonight, there's not going to be an opportunity for the public to comment on general matters or the agenda. So suspending, it's just a limited suspension while the governor's executive order is in place. If the executive orders are lifted, and you would go back to your regular procedures. So it's just a housekeeping item, and as long as and at this point in time, anybody who has a question about something that came up on the agenda, all of our emails are accessible through the city's website, and comments can be submitted. I have often received comments through the city's website about all kinds of things on the agenda when things haven't been uploaded properly. So that's fine.
Right. So because that was one of my main concerns, you know, because we're always trying to have public engagement. And so even when there is something, a hot topic that brings the public out, I'm always happy to see them out, because while the mayor and this council, we're very diligent in seeking out things and asking questions and getting information, there's always an aspect that comes from the community that I feel that we need to hear, especially before a vote. There's always information that they do bring to us that we might have missed also. So understanding that we're in new territory here, you know, I can see this for a temporary time. I was going to, I considered the possibility of doing a Facebook Live, but then I changed my mind on that because I didn't think they wanted to just stare at my face for the whole 2 hour or whatever meeting. But that community engagement part is important. So if we figure out a way to say to our community that during COVID-19, during this state of emergency, while we're not having the public come in, this is an avenue for you to send in your questions or comments, that would make me feel...
I'm fairly confident that there's a way to set up another email address. It could be public comment.
We will certainly do that. I mean, the public comment
at the city of Newburgh.
Yes.
You know.
Yes.
That's certain.
That would be great.
I'm fairly confident that the IT would be able to do that, and then we would have to work amongst ourselves to sift through those emails and distribute them to the appropriate council member or staff member to respond to that email.
Okay.
So I don't think that would be too difficult.
Thank you.
Yeah, I guess I'd like, and I know this is the first week of under this new norm, right? And I get the feeling we're going to be in this new norm for a bit longer than a lot of folks would probably want, myself included. And I guess I'd want us to think about I know cost is an issue, always an issue for us, and we're probably going to have more issues around our budget given what we're going through, but I would love for us to tinker and play around with a way that it doesn't add any more to the workload that folks are going to have already, in the sense of, like, if I emailed after I've seen it online, then there's another added step that I'm going to be having to do for the staffers, right? Because it's going to be after the fact. It's not going to be time-wise. I don't know if we do it, you know, either through Facebook, it gets recorded, and then it gets entered through Zoom as well. It could be live streamed at the same time. I know there's a cost associated, right, for having a business account via Zoom. I'm just trying to think, you know, in a way that's not adding more to the workload, that is still cost-effective, that is still allowing for that interaction that we have.
And so what I would also just say to that is at least for the next meeting cycle that you have is in April. I'm going to suggest that we reschedule the April 8th work session for Monday, April 13th in a similar format to this for two reasons. One, I don't think the public emergency is going to subside in the next 3 weeks, and April 8th is also one of the Passover Seders. So there's staff that would be requesting a change in that meeting. That would give us 3 full weeks between tonight's meeting and April 13th to address a lot of these, a lot of your concerns that we were unable to address in the urgency and the immediacy of what occurred in the last basically 5 days.
Right.
Yeah, so because I wanted to, and I'm sorry that I was a little distracted, my children are, they're in close quarters at home. So whatever that brings.
Understood.
So I'm gonna try to move my phone away from me. The other issue is what Councilmember Mejia brought out. You know, if we can look at technology as a way to incorporate, that public comment as well during that live time, so that would be back, so that it would be more responsive, that would be great as well.
Yes, I mean, public comments and you know, the participation of the public and the effectiveness and the efficiency of these meetings here. Certainly something that we take very seriously. So, you know, I can assure everyone gathered here this evening and watching live stream that we will certainly, we have already began exploring a number of different available options to us. And certainly by the next meeting on the 13th of April, we will have much more clarity as to what that looks like, and we will be certain to publicize what that looks like in advance of the next meeting as well.
Also, I just want to just kind of share with the healthcare crisis, COVID-19, you know, it is a very different and fluid situation, unique and different. I don't know of anything like this in our nation's history or even in world history as it relates to the contemporary context, but also when you look at technology, there may be a way where we could address some of the public comments on the screen here via...
There may be a way, at least when we do like webinars and stuff, there's ways for people who may have computer access to type in their questions and somebody can
read those things out loud
and then address them. So.
Right.
Like I said, we have
time to figure that out.
Following this meeting, because of all the orders that came in such rapid succession and so close in time to the council meeting, we haven't really had a chance to investigate all of those other options, which clearly this is not the optimal solution.
Right.
But by postponing that one work session, it gives us now 3 full weeks to try and digest all of the changes that have been imposed upon not just local government, but local businesses and schools and everybody else, and to try to find meaningful solutions to accommodate all of those needs going forward for as long as we're in the situation that we're in.
Okay.
And I'd be happy to help in that area.
Perfect. Thank you. All right. Well, on that note, then, we motion out of this meeting and motion into
City Council meeting. The executive session can be held at the very end of the council meeting because there's nothing that is going to require a formal vote. I just need to update you on a couple of things.
Okay.
And so we're going to take a quick break.
Commercial break.
Yeah. We'll take a 5-minute break.
Yeah.
Do we have a motion to go into executive session? Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
All in favor?
Anybody opposed?
Aye. Any opposed? Thank you.